to castigate one another.
Yeah.
And it was a very challenging period of time. It lasted for more than 4 years.
That's what I was curious. How many years?
Actually, more than four years.
When the tunnel was finally built, where were you at that time?
Well, when the tunnel was finally built, it's ironic because we had started construction on the tunnel after we had convinced the government to support this. Mm-hmm. And when we did, almost immediately after that, we received an unsolicited offer from MGM Resorts to buy Mirage Resorts.
Yeah.
So we never actually built the casino resort, but a major casino resort known as the Borgata, which is arguably the best resort in the Northeast, was created on this very piece of property.
Yeah. So it was sort of a Pyrrhic victory.
In many ways it was, but again, you have to look at the fact that now thousands and thousands of jobs have been created as a result of the project that was built there, and a lot of economic advantages for not only the city and the county, but also for the state of New Jersey.
Now, you do say that while you were involved with that, you still had a commute to home. And your wife is in this picture, as is Steve Wynn's ex-wife, Elaine.
Right. They were a big part of the support system for us during this period of time. I was living in Connecticut, and as you mentioned, commuting to Atlantic City, it was always so tenuous, not knowing if we were ever going to be able to get the project done or not. It made no sense to pick up stakes and move to Atlantic City because this was on one day and off the next. And and during this battle that was taking place, we had the best of times and the worst of times because we had the political process that we had to deal with on a city and state level.
And the governor was pretty good.
The governor was great. Christy Todd Whitman, the governor of New Jersey, suffered a lot of body blows because, again, Trump and Goldberg were attacking her for supporting this. They put ads in the newspaper and called this roadway, this tunnel, a driveway to Steve Wynn's door. Why would the state of New Jersey pay to finance this?
I read it as I said it. I thought, how did he survive this?
It was a very difficult period of time.
Yeah.
And looking back, it's one of the reasons why I wrote the book. I actually thought it would be cathartic for me to put this down on paper.
Yeah.
And a lot of people encouraged me to tell the story because the backstory is actually the more important, more interesting part of this. Yeah.
Well, what the backstory is, you can't fight City Hall, and politicians are politicians.
Politicians are politicians. It's difficult to generalize, to say, that all politicians are one way or another.
Yeah.
If you get lucky, you find certain elected officials. We had a state senator by the name of William Gormley, who was another honest person in the political process who was a great strategist as well and who saw what Steve Wynn had done when he had the Golden Nugget of Atlantic City and he wanted Steve Wynn back. He didn't care about being attacked by Donald or by anyone else. He was willing to stand up. Now others, of course, shirked their responsibility and hid.
Yeah.
But if you get lucky, you get the right politicians.
How did
involved.
The two of them ever get together?
Well, it's interesting. Steve and Donald didn't start off as enemies. Steve and Donald, I actually remember one time when we first opened the Mirage in Las Vegas, when Steve gave gave Donald Trump and Donald's then wife, Ivana, a tour of the Mirage.
Mm-hmm.
And they got along famously.
Yeah.
And interestingly, Steve, Donald, and I all, spent time together in Las Vegas. Mm-hmm. But then Donald felt that Steve was encroaching on his territory and didn't want that to happen on his turf. And that's what started it. And then Donald is sort of an outsized personality. When Donald goes on the attack, he can attack like no one else.
Yeah.
I was on CNN with Soledad O'Brien, and she asked me about being in a fight with Donald. And I said, if you can't stand the sight of your own blood, don't get into a fight with Donald Trump.
He's
a tough guy.
Yeah. When you walked away, how much? Oh, so really, no money was lost on that deal, because in between you had the Kirk Kerkorian group buying out Mirage and taking care.
Right. Well, to put it in proper sequence, actually what happened was when MGM Resorts bought the company, they put a value on this 200 acres of land that was at that point, now that the tunnel was being built, this land was worth literally hundreds of millions of dollars. Yeah. So to sort of tie a knot around this, what happened, one of the things that is unique about Steve Wynn and unique about Donald Trump is they both have the ability to put things behind them. When they're in a battle, they're in a battle. But when it's over, it's over. So many people can get into a protracted fight that the fight takes on a life of its own. They can't even remember what they were fighting about. These are two businessmen that at all times understand business and understand that you move on when it's time to move on.
When you moved on, though, and you get involved with the Indian tribe in Palm Springs, that's, now that, I have to say, is fodder for a film.
Yeah, well, it's interesting. You know, I was heading up all the new development opportunities for Mirage Resorts. And this was at a time when Steve was the first person to predict the spread of casino gambling throughout America. Because again, the only casinos early on were in Nevada in the 30s, and then it wasn't until the 70s that they moved to New Jersey. And today, you through Indian gaming and other reasons, you have more than 40 states that have casino gambling.
Yeah, but you had an Indian chief there who was the worst bigot I've ever heard about, but funny, because he didn't realize who he was talking to. But let me ask you, because underneath your name, it says you were chairman of the board and founder of, is that only on the internet? Give me the whole title.
Okay, well, I'm chairman of U.S. Digital Gaming, because if we look at the gaming industry that started with casinos in Nevada and then, as I said, to New Jersey and now spreading throughout the country and now internationally with casinos in Macau and Singapore, the next big thing in the casino industry is online. So we started a company, colleagues of mine and I started a company 3 years ago based here in Los Angeles called U.S. Digital Gaming to take advantage of the next big thing in the gaming industry.
Do you think New York will allow gambling in the city?
That is one of the big questions. You know, a company called Genting from Malaysia built a casino at Aqueduct Racetrack, and it is setting records in terms of volume. All they have are slot machines. It's not full casino gambling. It's only slot machines at
the
present time.
That's funny, because they don't allow slots other places.
Right, right. Yeah. The business is, it's hard to sometimes totally figure out some of the mentality around the political decisions that involve gambling. Yeah. But, you know, at some point in time, I believe without a doubt there'll be casino gambling in New York City, as there will be in every major city where there isn't gambling already.
Yeah. I do know that a man we talked about earlier who had been president of the Directors Guild and of the Academy, his father used to be a bookie upstairs in one of the restaurants in New York, which being a bookie was gambling.
Well, it's interesting. Look at lottery. That today 43 states have lottery, and it really took the numbers runners, if you will, the original numbers business. I remember in our neighborhood, there was a local a local guy by the name of Benny who would come to my dad and others in the neighborhood and collect a dollar from them for these numbers bets that the closing balance in the treasury that was printed in the newspaper was how they would determine those last three digits would determine the winner. What happened was the states went into the business with lottery and they put Benny out of business. So, you know, that's pretty much what's happened throughout the country.
Well, it's also the first time I've heard Governor Cuomo in New York mentioning it in Albany about allowing gambling to come in.
Right. I think it's interesting. You look at Deval Patrick, who is the governor of Massachusetts. Yeah. He was an outspoken opponent of casino gambling, and they put him in the car and drove him to Connecticut, where they have two major Indian casinos, Mohegan Sun and Foxwoods. And what did he find when he got there? Mostly Massachusetts license plates in the parking lot.
Yeah.
So he said, wait a second, I still don't think this is a good idea.
Yeah.
But if we're exporting our tax dollars and our jobs to Connecticut, that doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
So now there will be three casinos in Massachusetts shortly.
And, oh, I didn't realize that.
Yeah. Throughout the country.
Well, all I can say is the book is, as I said, small town boy really was there in the middle of it all. And I wish you much good luck. And truly, Skip, it's a great read. I think it's a terrific book for anybody at business school to see how things are really done.
Thanks, Connie.
You're welcome. Will you autograph my book?
I'd be delighted.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. And we'll tell you about some other books, but you can also read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. You can link into YouTube and our channel there, or to the Claremont Graduate University Digital Library, which has digitized really over close to 3,000 shows. And in that group, you can find people such as Norman Mailer or Sidney Sheldon or, the governor of Al Gore. So these are just some of the people you'll find there, but support your local library. Libraries are our finest democratic institution in the United States of America. It is where anyone can go in, get a library card, and they learn, if you take a child with you, they learn to be responsible. You've got to take that card out, you've got to get the book and return it on time and in the condition you took it out. What did a library mean to you growing up in Hartford?
Well, I'm listening to what you're saying about libraries, and I'm thinking, I was a paper boy early on, and I told my sons, you can learn everything you need to know about business if you have a paper route, because you know about being responsible, being on time. You find out that some people will reward you for good service, and other people will attempt not to pay you. So you learn all the basic tenets of business through being a paper boy, and you can certainly learn a lot at the library, without a
doubt.
Thank
you, Skip, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thanks.